come from a small town in southeast Poland called Janów Lubelski, where nature played a huge part in my life and where we used local plants for healing. My fascination with Australian flora guided me to my current research project, which focuses on aesthetic exploration of Australian plants with healing properties. I use a biochrome process to create the artwork. It is based on combining photographic and organic materials. It's subject to organic decay over a period of time. In this instance, I use local plants that were used for thousands of years by the first Australians, and I engage in dialogues with the Kwandamuka people of Minjiriba, that is North Stradbroke Island. I feel very privileged to be able to do that and to learn from them about their connection to land, about looking after it, about the island's biodiversity, and to share stories. The island is a very beautiful and inspiring place, and it's very dear to me. The exhibition is called Unfolding Rhythms and it consists of works on paper and time-lapse photography. Since the beginning of photography, plants were used in image making. For example, some pioneers of photography like William Henry Fox Talbot was using plants to create his first photograms. He's developed light-sensitive materials and some of the beautiful images that we can still see today are of plant specimens. His contemporary Anna Atkins also used plants to create cyanotype images, and they both were making photograms, which are actually, the technique is very close to biochromes because of the fact that they both require a direct contact of the object with the photographic materials. Anna Atkins was the first woman photographer and the first person to illustrate a book by using photographic techniques. She used the cyanotype and photogram techniques to image British algae. So by placing the specimens directly onto the light-sensitive materials and exposing them to light, so the resulting images are actually of the plant specimens and they're the same size as the specimens themselves. I really like working with photograms as well and cyanotypes, you know, this historical process that we still use today, because the images are these shapes and shadows and these traces of objects that were placed on these photosensitive materials. A photogram is a very close technique to biochrome because of the fact that he placed the specimen directly onto the photosensitive materials. However, they develop or are exposed to each other for a period of time. Sometimes it will take 5 to 8 weeks for them to develop. And also at the end, I like to enlarge them so you can actually see a lot of details, a lot of what actually happened during this process of decomposition and growth, this regeneration within these little ecosystems that I create between the plants for the microorganisms to thrive. So I create these environments for the biochromes to develop over time, and the bacteria, fungi, they grow over time, and the best way to see what actually is happening is in time-lapse photography. For a long time I wanted to document the process and it wasn't very successful, and it was very difficult to document the different stages of development as they can't be disturbed. So once they're disturbed, the continuity is not as effective, and there's lots of other factors that actually come into the documentation of the process. So a couple of years ago I started making time lapses of the process, and which was also very challenging to actually find a technique that will work effectively so you can actually see it while it's developing off throughout the whole period of time over the few weeks. I
I'm really interested in John Cage's indeterminacy, which is obviously related to aleatoric music. The idea where you cannot determine the sonic outcome of each individual moment in time, but that you're constructing an environment which is a very determined environment in which indeterminacy happens. And that's what I'm really fascinated by and have been, I guess, learning from Renata's work, is that the actual small moments in time are these uncontrolled things. You don't know where the next drop's going to happen, you don't know where the next bubble's going to happen, but the actual delight is all this indeterminacy that's happening, the sort of the illogical that's happening within the logical frame. And then there's the whole, the physicality, the kinetic part of actually constructing sound, which I really like the effortful. I hate effortlessness. It's generally quite soft sound. Huge amounts of energy going into creating this almost wind chime tinkling underneath. So in that process, while I say it's indeterminate, there's obviously a whole lot of knowledge coming in, a whole lot of behaviours that you're learning, a whole lot of techniques you're starting to understand, the behaviour of objects, the behaviour of your body, the physicality, the strength, the endurance. And then after that time, as in meditation, you're entering into a space. And for me, it's a pre-existing space. I'm re-entering a space that has habits. It has its own lexicon, it has its own language. To me, that's what improvisation is. It's like you're developing a language so that you can spontaneously be where you are. In reality, I can't untrain myself as a classical percussionist, which is my training, and also as an improviser. So improvisation has become, after classical music, has become my main language. So I think all of those ideas to do with form, rhythm, structure, acceptance, that's that experience. Being able to listen in real time, which is kind of a weird thing that's hard to learn to do, strangely enough, especially for classical musicians, because we're preemptive musicians. We want to know what we intend to do, and then we want to reenact the intent. So this idea of listening in real time and being able to flow is actually a behavior that I'm really, really interested in, and I've had to really concentrate on. The learning process for that is more about meditation and putting yourself in difficult or at least varied performative situations with musicians you don't know, with audiences you don't know. So you're constantly building up a repertoire of acceptance and readiness, which is totally different from the classical tradition. But yeah, it's underlying that. That's the bed in which this sits. It's no longer inhabited in that tradition. I try and incorporate a variety of objects so I have a palette. I'm interested in discarded waste, recycled materials, rubbish, repurposing, and finding ways in which we can reimagine our own environment. So I'm interested in objects that are not sonically considered, the palette of sound that would give scope to really kind of interact with the detail in Renata's works. You know, collaboration, I think that's just an amazing regenerator. We talk about professional development, but really collaboration is professional development. It's this idea of seeing what you do through someone else's perspective. How do I communicate my ideas to someone who does not come from the same tradition? How can we use collective creativity in order to drive forward a project? So I think having artists of different art forms working in parallel is really, it's so rewarding. It's that kind of just learning in tandem that I think is very beautiful. Another thing that I always feel when I'm watching her time lapses is not that this is a process of decay, but this is just that cycle, which is very, very much how I think of the sound that I'm making. I don't feel like the piece starts and stops. I bring it back to life and then I cease to bring it to life. And it's the same with her time lapses. It's like they're just constantly in a state of transformation and they seem to have no beginning and no end. And I think that's what's kind of alluring to me, is not that they're a linear thing, but that they're in a cyclical perpetual motion.
I think what's exciting about the process is that although it's kind of a paradox because of the creating new image, new aesthetics through this destruction, through decay, we can actually see how cyclic the whole system is, how we are part of the cycle of life, and through this decay, the regeneration at the same time of microbes, of different life is visible, and things that we don't really see otherwise, we don't have a chance to see, or we don't contemplate, and decay stays all around us, but we don't sort of stop and think about it. In the time lapses, we can actually observe this process, and with the loop that you can actually watch it over and over again and see this cycle happen in front of your eyes. And the manipulation of time, I think, creates a very different idea and look at, from our point of view, at the decay and renewal and how nature is all about cycles, all about rhythms that are present in nature that we experience on different levels, and also the connection that we can have with natural processes. When I started making biochromes, my sister was at uni at the time and she was studying microbiology and biotechnology. She was telling me about microorganisms, bacteria, fungi, and a Vinogradsky column. The column is a laboratory demonstration of microorganic activities, of bacterial ability to thrive within a created environment. So in this artificial setting, in a glass column, you can watch and observe the microbes thriving by using energy from light, but also energy from their own microorganic functions. And using this idea to create biochrome is by creating this artificial setting or environment for them to thrive and reproduce. It illustrates microorganic functions and also how through these biological activities of one organism, another is able to grow, reproduce, and then through metabolism allow the system to be self-sustaining. It presents also multitude of colors and textures, and that's also one of the things that are very exciting in creating biochrome imagery. I think that microbes are quite fascinating. They can live in extreme environments, and if it wasn't for microbes, there would be no life. We need them. We need them to recycle. And by creating these environments for them, we are able to observe what happens during that decay and regrowth and regeneration process. And the photographic materials, because of the color layers, gelatin, and the way they actually made, they actually perfect grounds for breeding of microorganisms together with the plant matter.